conditions. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is a fecal occult blood test. We used to call this guaiac testing, and we used to guaiac all stools in the ICU, but I guess it got expensive because now we don't do that anymore. We only do it on people we suspect are going to have GI bleeding. Okay, so that's the reason you would do a fecal occult blood test. Okay, you have to teach your patient to avoid vitamin C rich foods, red meat, poultry, or fish because it could cause a false positive. You need 3 samples also. Okay, a colonoscopy is done. I'm going to go into some tests now. Colonoscopy is done to detect polyps and cancer. Oftentimes, the physician will remove a polyp because a polyp is going to probably turn into cancer during a colonoscopy. So after age 50, everybody needs to have their first one by age 50. With older adults, okay, before you have a colonoscopy, you have to clear out your bowel. And this is not fun, okay, but it has to be done because if the provider can't see inside your colon, it's going to do you no good. You're going to have to come back. So just get it right the first time. So you have to drink the prep, whatever that is all different kinds. And you have to start like 2 days before. So you have, clear liquid diet. Okay. But you're going to have like diarrhea forever until everything is coming out clear. So you keep doing the prep until everything is clear. So with older adults, you're worried about them doing a bowel prep because they could run into fluid and electrolyte imbalances like a low potassium or metabolic acidosis. So you'd have to be careful of that. After somebody's had a colonoscopy, it's real easy, or not real easy, it's real common to hear your patients passing lots of flatulence. When I worked like in a day surgery place, I mean, it's unbelievable how much flatulence they have. So let's move on. You are going to have to revisit the proper order of physical assessment techniques that are involved in abdominal assessment. So you're going to start with inspection of the abdomen. Then you auscultate. The reason you auscultate before you even touch the abdomen is you don't want to move the bowels around because it's going to skew your auscultation. In other words, it could make the bowels really hyperactive when they're not really. Then percussion, then palpation. Now think of this. If you're doing a focused assessment, abdominal assessment, your patient is not going to let you touch them, right? Do palpation if they're in pain. So you do that last and you do the area that is not affected or the least painful area first. Now we're going to talk about hernias. There's all different types of hernias. If you look at my PDF and my recording, you can see the different types of hernias. I'm going to talk more about like what's the difference between a reducible and irreducible hernia, because with irreducible or incarcerated, we call them hernias, you're worried that the patient is going to end up with an intestinal obstruction. Reducible means you can put them back into place. Okay, so we don't worry so much about that. Patients can live for a long time with reducible hernias. When it's not, it cannot be moved back in place, that we call that irreducible or incarcerated. And that means that the patient needs a surgical evaluation because you're worried about them getting an intestinal obstruction. So that would be an example of a mechanical intestinal obstruction. A strangulated hernia is similar to incarcerated, but a strangulated hernia is like necrotic. There's like, it could result in intestinal obstruction, necroses, and perforations, which means rupture of the bowel. And you never want rupture of the bowel or perforation because then all the contents of the colon are going to be going into the peritoneal cavity and the patient get peritonitis and die from this, okay? So the signs and symptoms you're going to anticipate in a client that had either an incarcerated or strangulated hernia that would make you think they have a bowel obstruction is tachycardia, abdominal distension, vomiting, especially if it smells like fecal matter, and fever. All right. What you're going to auscultate in somebody that has an intestinal obstruction, and this is important for you to understand, you're going to hear high-pitched tinkling sounds above the obstruction. So like in one quadrant, you might hear high-pitched tinkling sounds. And below the obstruction, they're going to have hypoactive sounds. So hypoactive sounds means like when you're listening to the bowel sounds, right? You know you have to listen for a full 5 minutes. But if you don't hear anything within the first 30 seconds, or the bowel sounds are real infrequent, they have hypoactive bowel sounds. Okay, so what I just talked about with strangulated hernia and incarcerated hernia, these are a type of mechanical intestinal obstruction. Now, a non-mechanical intestinal obstruction is a paralytic ileus. That's an example of a non-mechanical intestinal obstruction. And patients usually get this after surgery. So one of the things we do for that is have the patient ambulate so they can start passing gas. Once they pass flatus, that means that peristalsis has begun again and the patient no longer has a paralytic ileus. All right, the life-threatening complication of intestinal obstruction is perforation and peritonitis. All right, so the cues to peritonitis are board-like rigid abdomen, fever, nausea and vomiting, abdominal distension and tenderness with guarding, and a high WBC. Now I'm going to go in and talk about gastritis. It's one of the non-inflammatory conditions of the GI tract. What causes it? It's very similar to what causes GERD, what causes peptic ulcer disease. So it would be H. pylori, NSAIDs, too much alcohol, smoking, and caffeine. What you worry for a patient that has gastritis is that this could result in GI hemorrhage, okay? So you're going to tell, you would have to teach your patient not to do these things. Don't use NSAIDs. Don't drink a lot. Don't smoke. And don't drink caffeine, all right? Now I'm going to move into constipation. To prevent constipation, you would tell your patient to try to defecate at the same time each day. Increase fiber, so bulk-forming foods in the diet. Increase their activity level. Increase fluid, so drink more water. And then the sequence of meds that you would recommend. First, you always start with the bulk-forming, right? You start with the least invasive, I guess, and then move up. Like stool softeners would be next, and then laxatives. You would never want a patient to take laxatives daily because then they get then they need laxatives to go. Like it's not good for bowel training. And then enema would be the last resort because that is invasive. Now I'm going to switch gears and talk about GERD. This is the most common upper GI problem, and it's prevalent in our country. And it occurs due to a weakened lower esophageal sphincter. And if you look at my other recordings, I have pictures of what that would look like. Again, the risk factors are obesity, excessive alcohol consumption, smoking, hiatal hernia. In fact, a hiatal hernia, you would give the same teaching to somebody with a hiatal hernia in pregnancy. How is GERD diagnosed? By endoscopy. Anybody going for endoscopy, meaning they have a scope put in their mouth, either an EGD or an ERCP, all right, you need to make sure you're checking for a gag reflex after, because these are done under moderate sedation. But also they numb like the back of the throat so the patient can aspirate. So you need to check for a gag reflex. Which foods should the client with GERD avoid? Well, this would be the same for gastritis, hiatal hernia, peptic ulcer disease. So avoid spicy foods, avoid alcohol, avoid carbonated drinks, chocolate, coffee. They have to avoid those kind of foods. And here are your instructions. For somebody that has GERD, raise the head of the bed 6 to 8 inches, no smoking. They need to be MPO for at least 2 hours before bedtime. It can be more, but at least for 2 hours. They need a low-fat diet, no smoking, alcohol, or caffeine, and no tight clothing. Now, with peptic ulcer disease, again, H. pylori is the culprit. And same with GERD, H. pylori. So these are all very similar conditions. Aspirin and NSAID use, that's classic for ulcers. So the type of ulcer, duodenal and gastric ulcers are both peptic ulcers. So the one that feels better with food is duodenal. And that makes sense because when you eat food, it goes to the stomach first, right? The type of peptic ulcer that wakes them up at night. So 3 hours after eating is when patients with duodenal ulcers feel the pain. Gastric ulcer, it feels worse after eating because the food goes directly to the stomach. And then gastric ulcers may present with vomiting blood or coffee grounds vomitus. Whereas duodenal ulcers, they'll have black tarry stools. All right, now I'm going to go into tube feeds. And if you're feeding a patient with something nasogastric or any kind of feeding, you always want to check the placement with a chest x-ray. That is the gold standard. The complications for enteral feedings include aspiration, clogged tube, diarrhea. All right. So if your patient has diarrhea while receiving enteral feedings, you want to slow the wait and notify the provider. Send the stool for C. diff. You'll probably have to do that and collab with the dietitian because it could be that the formula has too much glucose in it. Also, you want to make sure you're checking the residuals. You know, tube feedings can be continuous or they can be bolus, right? And you're worried about aspiration in both of them. But if you check the residual, and you usually do it every 4 to 6 hours, and it's greater than 100 to 200 to almost 200 mLs, you need to hold it, okay? Because you're going to overfeed and they could be at risk for aspiration, all right? Now I'm going to talk about total parenteral nutrition, and this is used as a last resort. And this would be used for people like with inflammatory bowel disease, people whose gut is not working. That's who you would reserve this for. Everybody else, if the GI tract is working, even if peristalsis is not that great, they will start them on a low-dose enteral feeding. It's so much better than TPN because TPN has a lot of complications with it. First of all, the dextrose solution is 10%, so that means it has to be infused through a central line, and you use that port in the central line for TPN and TPN only. You don't put antibiotics through it. Nothing goes through it, okay? You should never speed up the TPN solution, and you would only slow it down when they were tapering off, okay? TPN always needs to be weaned. You can't just stop it abruptly because if you do, the patient's going to become hypoglycemic. And you change the tubing every 24 hours to prevent infection, and it's always under sterile technique. You need to check blood sugars every 4 to 6 hours, even on patients that are not diabetic, because even non-diabetics are going to have a high blood sugar on when they first start TPN because the pancreas can't crank out the insulin quick enough. If your TPN runs out, you're supposed to keep a liter of D10 in the room, which nobody really does, but you're going to hang a liter of D10 at the same rate that it's going at. Now I'm going to switch gears and talk about bariatric surgery. So bariatric surgery is reserved, it's weight loss surgery, right, for people with a BMI greater than 40 or a BMI greater than 35 with at least one severe obesity-related comorbidity, such as hypertension, diabetes, something like that, okay? The purpose, the restrictive bariatric surgeries reduce the stomach volume. So some examples of this are your lap bariatric surgeries, like laparoscopic adjustable gastric banding, lap sleeve banding, vertical banded gastroplasty. Now, the malabsorption surgeries are your root and Y gastric bypass, where they actually dissect part of the stomach, okay? So you kind of have to understand the difference between the both. Now, if somebody has a root and Y gastric bypass, you need to be on high alert for an anastomic leak, which means a leak in the sutures that the surgeon has sewn, okay? So look for tachycardia, restlessness, shoulder pain, back pain, and oliguria. Now, this could kill them, so this is important. Patients that undergo the Roux-en-Y are going to be at risk for dumping syndrome, and ATI loves dumping syndrome. So know how to recognize it with these signs and symptoms. They're under stress, so they're going to have diaphoresis, tachycardia, they'll have cramping, diarrhea, and they often have palpitations. So you need to know the interventions that are going to help prevent dumping syndromes. So withhold PO fluids during a meal. They need to drink 60 minutes after a meal, so they need to drink between meals. It's caused by refined sugar, sweet drinks, lactose. So avoid simple sugars and milk products, like no sodas. They shouldn't even have carbonated stuff. They need to eat 6 meals a day. They need to eat slowly and chew well. They need to lie down after meals to slow stomach emptying. Now, this is different than GERD, so take note of that. They need a high protein, high fat, low fiber, and low carb diet. So this is very important for you to know. Now we're going to talk about stoma surgeries, a lot of different stoma surgeries. So we're just going to talk in some generalities, okay? One of the most important things, you know, after you've checked A, B, and C, right? You want to make sure that the patient's new stoma is shiny and moist or wet looking, red and protruding, okay? You never want to see pale, dark red, or purple, brown, or black stomas, because that means that the blood supply to the stoma is not good. An ileostomy is located in the right lower quadrant, and the opening of the stoma appliance should be 1/16 to 1 inch larger than the stoma to prevent constriction. Okay, now I'm going to talk about inflammatory bowel diseases. So Crohn's and ulcerative colitis, we can kind of compare and contrast them. With Crohn's disease, it affects all areas of the GI tract, from mouth to anus, whereas ulcerative colitis only affects the large colon. The pain is usually in the right lower quadrant for Crohn's disease and the left upper quadrant for ulcerative colitis. So if you have a patient, now both of these conditions are characterized with periods of exacerbation and remission. So if somebody's in the hospital with an exacerbation, you're going to monitor the frequency and characters of stools. You're going to check their bowel sounds. You're going to check their weight and INOs. Okay. How is the diet for both of these? They need low fiber diet. They need high protein and fluids. Now I'm going to talk about appendicitis. The pain is going to be in the umbilicus going towards the right lower quadrant, okay? And then diverticulosis and diverticulitis. So as you age, you're going to be more at risk for diverticulosis, which happens in older adults, and it's little outpouchings of the large colon. What can happen is these outpouching areas can get inflamed, and then we call that diverticulitis. Okay, so the patient needs to stop eating like seeds and nuts, but just make sure you understand that distinction. All right, now I'm going to talk about cholecystitis. And cholecystitis is inflammation of the gallbladder. Now, it can be due to stones, it can happen without stones, but stones are called cholelithiasis, okay? So those are gallstones. And how they're treated is, if somebody has gallstones or cholecystitis, it can be treated with diet. Low fat, low gas producing foods are going to be recommended. Medications, like they have gallstone dissolving medications, weight loss, so you would just tell the patient to lose weight and that may help, or surgery. Okay, those are the treatment options for gallstones or cholelithiasis or cholecystitis. Okay, so not everybody that has gallstones, I mean, they could do nothing, right? It's only if the gallstones are bothering you and it turns into cholecystitis. So the risk factors for cholecystitis include the six F's. fair, which means Caucasian, fat, which I think you know what that means, BMI greater than 30, right? 40 years old, females, family and fertile, and also people that are sedentary, people that don't get a lot of exercise, probably why they have a high BMI. And then there's a familial or genetic. So if your mother had it, you might be more prone to it. The metabolic risk factors, these are all the signs of metabolic syndrome. Okay. Women are more at risk because if they have estrogen or they're on birth control pills, they're going to be more at risk. Or if they're pregnant or multiparous, okay, they're going to be more at risk for cholecystitis. We, when I worked in the PACU of Cobb County, Georgia, a lot of pregnant people came in to have a lap chole. Patients with cholecystitis complain of ingestion and pain after eating fatty foods. So that's the key thing, fatty foods. The GI symptoms are going to have flatulence, eructation is burping, heartburn, which is dyspepsia, anorexia, feeling full, nausea, and vomiting. But the pain is in the right upper quadrant and it radiates to the shoulder. It's quite uncomfortable. They'll have a temperature. They may go for an ERCP. And the most important thing after that is to check for the gag reflex. They're going to have elevated white count, and the pain is managed. Remember, it's not always surgery. Avoiding fatty foods to prevent colic and drugs, okay, and medications. The diet should be high fiber, low fat, and avoid gas-producing foods. And they need to eat small, frequent meals. Now, a lap chole is kind of the standard operation. The post-op pain is less severe than when they have the open approach, okay? But because of where the surgery is in the right upper quadrant, when they breathe, they're going to have pain. So they don't like to do turncough deep breathe, so make sure they're medicated enough that they will do that, okay? After the surgery, they're going to have pain in the shoulders or the right thorax because when they do laparoscopic surgery, they put a lot of gas in there to kind of blow up the abdomen so the surgeon can see. So the best thing for that is if they complain of shoulder pain after surgery, you need to get them up and walking so that they can remove that gas, okay? So heat can also be helpful for gas pain. Usually, they can resume their normal activities in a week. If they have flatulence after surgery, that means peristalsis has returned. Why do they complain of pain in the shoulder or thorax? Because of the gas from surgery, so get them up and moving. All right, that's cholecystitis. Now I'm going to talk about pancreatitis, which students often get confused about. Now you have to remember the pancreas has an endocrine function, which means it secretes insulin, basically, right? And also an exocrine function, which means it secretes enzymes that help us digest food. So acute pancreatitis can be life-threatening. There's different degrees of how patients present with pancreatitis. The two most common causes are ETOH abuse and biliary obstruction. So something triggers the pancreas to release the digestive enzymes early, and then the pancreas auto-digests itself, okay? So in other words, somebody goes on a bender with alcohol, it triggers the pancreas to secrete the enzymes early, and then since there's no food, the enzymes are going to start auto-digesting the pancreas. Now, patients with pancreatitis are going to have hypocalcemia, and we talked about that for exam 2, so you should be well-versed in the signs and symptoms of hypocalcemia. All right, the pain in pancreatitis is continuous, intense, and boring, meaning it rips right through the body, usually mid-gastric to left upper quadrant pain, radiates to the back, shoulder, and left flank. Patients are going to be more comfortable in the fetal position or sitting upright and leaning forward with their knees bent. Pain is going to be increased by lying supine. Now, there's two abdominal signs I need to teach you. One is called Gray Turner sign, and one is called Cullen sign. So, Gray Turner sign is ecchymosis in the flanks, and it indicates retroperitoneal bleeding. And Cullen sign is ecchymosis in the umbilical area. It can be seen with pancreatitis, but also like an ectopic pregnancy. And it means the patient is bleeding retroperitoneal and also intraperitoneal. Okay, so those are the two signs. This is what they look like. So just be on the lookout and, you know, get their vital signs to make sure they're not actively bleeding. All right, now your patient may have absent or decreased bowel sounds, right? If they are passing gas or having a BM, it means that they have peristalsis. The labs you're going to look at are increased amylase and lipase, and the most sensitive one is lipase because it remains elevated longer. Amylase only remains elevated for 3 days, but it's also elevated in other conditions. So earlier I had mentioned that the two most common causes are alcohol and gallbladder disease, or I should say biliary stone disease. So if they're obstructed, they're going to have their, let me start again. If the bile duct is obstructed, they're going to have a high ALT. They'll have high liver function tests. They'll get high because the liver gets stressed out when there's a stone in the common bile duct. Gray Turner's I talked about, Cullen's I talked about. The other labs you'll see, like any itis, elevated WBC, decreased calcium due to fat necrosis. So to treat pancreatitis, you want to reduce the metabolic load. So the patient is going to be NPO. They're going to be on bed rest, and this helps control pain, right, if you put the patient in the fetal position. They're going to need IV fluids, antiemetics, an NG tube if they have paralytic ileus, and to control the pain. So we already talked about low calcium for the last exam, so you should know how to identify that. And then the best position is a side-lying fetal position or sitting up with the knees bent. The diet, once they start to heal and can eat, no caffeine, no alcohol, no spicy foods. Low fat is the other thing that's not on there. They have to have low fat. So no smoking, I already mentioned that. When patients go home, they may be very weak and confined to one floor. They may have to limit stairs. They need to stop drinking and smoking. May need a bedside commode because if they're not absorbing anything, they're going to have steatorrhea, and you'll learn about that more in pediatrics. All right, so chronic pancreatitis happens usually in alcoholics because they have repeated infections, and their life is characterized by remissions and exacerbations. So the two conditions that can result from chronic pancreatitis include diabetes mellitus, and you know that's unusual as an adult. They could have malnutrition because they can't absorb anything. So they're going to have to take pancrealipase, and you will learn about this also when you study cystic fibrosis in pediatrics, okay? So, and you probably had this in pharmacology as well. So this is like the biliary tree lecture.